Hello, dears. Knestor Jackdaws here on a very, very beautiful January afternoon here in Southern California, where I've been fortunate enough to be able to take a protracted little vacation. And I must say, as you can see, it is a splendid place to be. So many other parts of the world are either under some, savage deluge of water or snow or combinations thereof. I can tell you I feel very lucky to be here. And I felt it was very important to go outside, particularly on a day like today, which is so clear and beautiful and really, really singular. And as I was looking around at some of the sights, the branches and the blossoms, so many of the trees are in blossom, even in January, one shudders to think what will happen when the next real big freeze comes along. But until that moment, of course, it's absolutely lovely. And when you look at these patterns, particularly against a beautiful blue sky such as we have today, it began to remind me of course, works of art with which I'm so familiar and with which so many of us are familiar. Particularly, the work of Jackson Pollock, who was a very expressionistic and rather undisciplined but tremendously popular painter and very, very influential in his time and still today. And when you look at these branches and leaves and the sort of willy-nilly compositions that they provide against the sky, I mean, doesn't it remind you a little bit of the work of Jackson Pollock? Perhaps that's giving a little bit too much credit to Pollock. But after all, as I said, he did have tremendous influence. And when last I looked, his paintings are among the most valuable in the world. I should correct that, not the most valuable, but the most marketable in the world. In other words, they're worth the most on the art market. Are they valuable? I don't know. Have you got one hanging in your house? Or perhaps a print? I certainly don't. But they are valuable in someone's viewpoint, that's for sure. Anyway, he was a very skilled painter, and in thinking about Pollock, the great Pollock, I also realized that so much of his appeal was the tremendous spontaneous quality of his work, which does, in fact, echo the spontaneity and the raw life force in nature. He certainly was not a very patient person, was he? It looked like he had barely enough time to, do what he did, and then he was off to something else, God knows what. But in any case, one doesn't look at his work and say, ah, here is a patient, thoughtful man. However, it may just have been the technique. Perhaps he was. There's something to be said for the way that Jackson Pollock worked, by just simply dribbling, helter-skelter, bits of very opaque paint on a canvas or flinging it, which of course is very, very fun to do, I think, if you're not too tormented. And it's very similar to what the Sumi-e Japanese brush painters do, these great masters. But there does seem to be a bit of a difference. The Sumi-e, study and sort of work out what they're going to do, and they use chance, but they also can rein in chance to produce a specific sort of aesthetic product. So if you've not seen any of those, I do invite you to check them out, because it's a lovely work, very spiritual, and definitely shares a kinship with Jackson Pollock. Well, I've spoken so much about Pollock and so much about the weather and how nice I'm, what a good time I'm having, and that's all very well and good. But I really would like to know what you think. When you go outside and you look at the world around you, do you see things that remind you of the great works of art that you've seen in museums? Or perhaps do they remind you of great works of art in your own mind that you're going to produce? I'd be interested to know. And in that line, may I wish you a very Corbet morning, a very Caspar David Friedrich afternoon, and perhaps a nice J.M.W. Turner sunset. I'm Knestor Jackdaws. Ta-ta.